Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who sanctified us with his commandments and commanded us to engross ourselves in the words of the Torah. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech ha'olam asher kitzanu b'mitzvotav v'tzivenu la'asot b'dvarei Torah. Please, Adonai, make the Torah's words sweet in my mouth and in the mouth of all your people, the house of Israel. May we, your children, all of Israel, know your name and the name of your Messiah, Yeshua. And may we study your Torah simply because it is good. Blessed are you, Adonai, who gave us the Torah of truth. Come on, Tania.
Thank you.
Let's pray. Everybody extend your hand towards Tania. Abba, in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, we thank you for Tania. We ask you to anoint her words. Let her teach us from you, and we will receive it in the name of Yeshua. Amen, amen.
Can you hear me? Can you hear that? Oh. Well, Shabbat Shalom, everyone. Good morning, and thanks for having me down here. Thank you. All right. So today we're going to do the Torah portion, of course. And we're also going to watch a short video as part of the teaching this morning. Just so you know, the Torah portion is Kitavo, which you just heard Pastor Jeff talk about. It comes from Deuteronomy 26:1 through 29:8 or 9, depending on your translation. Also have the Half Torah up there and the Brit Hadashah if you're interested in those readings as well. So as the Torah portion begins this week, we see the Israelites receiving instructions from Yahweh in regards to entering the Promised Land. As we read through the Torah portion, we see there's lots of instructions in there. He tells them to possess the land. He tells them to dwell in the land. He gives instructions on offerings, sacrifices, particularly first fruits and tithing, and instructions on how to build an altar, and also how to write all of the Torah on these stones. So we see lots of different instructions as they're about to enter the Promised Land. Let's start with Deuteronomy 26:16. All right, Deuteronomy 26:16 reads, "Today, Yahweh your Elohim is commanding you to do these laws and right rulings, and you shall guard and do them with all your heart and with all your being." Well, the instructions that Yahweh gave his people in this Torah portion to possess the land, to dwell in the land, and sacrifices and offerings, he gave another command to the people that we actually see in the following Torah portion. But it's valid for the entire word, for the entire scriptures. We're going to talk about that today. This instruction would apply for them going into the Promised Land, but it applies for them every day, as it applies for us every day. So it's an instruction that we all need. We all need to live by it. Deuteronomy 31:23 says, "And he, Yahweh, commanded Yehoshua," or Joshua, "son of Nun, and said, 'Be strong and courageous. For you are to bring the children of Israel into the land of which I swore to them, and I myself am with you.'" This is what we're going to talk about today. Be strong and courageous. Rock Kazakh. Again in Joshua 1:5-9, we're going to read those scriptures. Yahweh gives the same command to Joshua and to his people. "Be strong and courageous, for you are to let this people inherit the land which I swore to their fathers to give them. Only be strong and courageous, to guard, to do according to all the Torah which Moshe, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn from it right or left, so that you act wisely wherever you go. Do not let this book of the Torah depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it night and day, so that you guard to do according to all that is written in it. For then you shall make you prosperous and your way prosperous, and act wisely. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid and do not be discouraged. For Yahuwah your Elohim is with you wherever you go." That's quite a pep talk, right? After those words, how could we be anything but strong and courageous? And yet we struggle with that each day. We struggle with that. But he tells them this, Yahweh tells them this over and over again. And just in that scripture from Joshua, we see it three times alone. Be strong and courageous. Doesn't the whole Bible tell us that? Be strong and courageous. Do not fear, because he's with you always. So he tells them not to let the words of the Torah depart from their mouth. I find that interesting that they put, that he included that in the part with the be strong and courageous, because it says not to depart from doing everything in the Torah. So that's obviously part of it. We have to do that in order to be strong and courageous. So what more could he possibly give us? What more could we need? He says he's with us always, always. So he gives us everything we need to be commanded to be strong and courageous, to follow him, to not be afraid, to be prosperous, and to be set apart as he calls us to be. He gave us his Torah. He gave us our instructions for life to follow. He gave us the ultimate sacrifice in his Son. That's a way back to him. He gave us his Ruach HaKodesh, which is our helper, daily helper, and our guide. And if that isn't enough, he gave us his holy armor. And I know Pastor Jeff just finished a teaching a while back about that, and that's something that's really influenced me as I try to repeat those verses daily. I'm sure everybody remembers it, from Ephesians 6, 11 through 18. So we're going to read just this portion today because it really has to do with the armor he gives us to be strong and courageous. So Ephesians 6, 11 through 18. Put on the complete armor of Elohim for you to have power to stand against the schemes of the devil, because we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against authorities, against world rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual wickedness in the Shemaim. Because of this, take up the complete armor of Elohim, so that you have power to withstand in the wicked day, and having done all, to stand. Stand then, having girded your waist with truth, put on the breastplate of righteousness, taking up the shield of belief, with which you have power to quench all the burning arrows of the wicked one. Take up also the helmet of deliverance and the sword of the Ruach, which is the word of Yahuwah, praying at all times with all prayer and supplication in the Ruach, watching in all perseverance and supplication for all the Kodeshim. So he gave us his battle gear. He said to gird our waist with his truth, to put on our breastplate of righteousness, to fit our feet with the good news of peace. He gave us his shield of belief, his helmet of deliverance, and the sword, which is this word. So we're protected every day if we put the armor on. We have to put the armor on every day. And he gives us to this because we're going to need it. I mean, we need it now, but it's going to get worse. And we're going to really need it more each and every day. So we need to do that every day, put on his armor. Deuteronomy 26, back to the Torah portion, 17 through 19. You have today caused Yahuwah to proclaim to be your Elohim, and to walk in his ways and guard his laws and his commands and his right rulings, and to obey his voice. And Yahweh has caused you to proclaim today to be his people, a treasured possession, as he has spoken to you, and to guard all his commands so as to make you high above all nations, which he has made for a praise and for a name, and for esteem, and for you to be a Kodesh people to Yahweh your Elohim, as he has spoken. So Yahweh set his people apart, and he expects us to act that way. He expects us to be set apart, and he's done the same he did for the Israelites, he does for us, because we are Israel, and we need to be set apart as they were required to be. Scripture says there's always a remnant. There's always a remnant. Throughout the word, the remnant always remains, and you always see that, and we're the remnant, so we need to act like it, right? We need to act like it. He requires something of us, though. He tells us to be set apart, to obey his word, to be strong and courageous in the spiritual battles that surround us and face us. But the good news is he's equipped us for that, and we're able to do that. So I mentioned a word earlier, Rock Kazakh. That's what Rock Kazakh is all about. It's a message we need to hear. It's a message we definitely need to hear as the adversary chooses to wage war against us more and more every day. So as we go into the short video that we're going to watch, just 6 minutes, but it really exemplified when I found it. It really struck me, and it has a lot of meaning. So I'm going to leave you with a question to think about as you watch it. Where is your war cry?
War cry throughout all the generations of the Hebrew nation. Rock, Kazakh. Where does it come from? Kazakh, this is the Hebrew, the rock-like oomph of the spiritually zealous heart, the game face of a mighty man, tenacity of soul, the gritting of the teeth of the spirit-inspired warrior, and the baring of those teeth to the enemy. Kazakh is possessing a resolute and growling resolve for the glory of God, a flush of spiritual fervor, a tensing of all a soldier's muscles. There's a Kazakh. We don't have that spiritually. We should. We don't. because we don't know what we're engaged with. Did you know that you have the armory of heaven? That you have everything you need for life and godliness to push the enemy forces back? And so when you hear a sock, your knuckles spiritually should immediately turn white, and you should find yourself gritting your spiritual teeth with a belligerence against the enemy. He goes down. There are souls that must be saved. Okay, that's just kasak. The Hebrew statement is rock kasak. However, in the Bible, where that came from, it's kasak emos. The other word that goes with it, emos. It's heavenly audacity. It's rushing headlong into the most hazardous and impossible battles without pausing to consider the impossibilities. Who had emos in the Bible? David against Goliath? That's some serious emos. Okay, he's rushing headlong against the Goliath. It's like, David, we might want to think about this a little. No, I'm not weighing the impossibilities. This is for my God. It's a confidence in victory even before the field is taken. It's lambs moving with liquid ferocity straight into the lion's lair. How about the three that overheard him in the cave of Adullam? Says, oh, for a cup of cool water from the well of Bethlehem. Those guys had a moss. They go running out, break through a garrison of Philistines to grab a cup of cool water and then bring it back through the garrison. They're being hunted by Philistines all the time, trying not to spill a cup of water. That's a moss. Mere men and women on earth are eaten up by the enemy. However, we're not just mere men and women of this earth. We are redeemed. We are bought with a price, and we've been changed into the body of Christ. Amos means swift-footed, all-believing, super-conquering, prevailing faith in the Lord of battles. What happens to the world if Christians once again get kasak and amos? You know what the apostles had after Pentecost? Something came into them. What was it? You can say it very simply. Kasak and amos. Spirit of God. He came in to win. He came in to turn this world on its head. Moses' last gasp. This is his great speech before the promised land, which he never got to enter into. And he's laying out the ground rules for the kingdom that is about to be established across that Jordan River. Be strong and of good courage. Kasak, amos. Fear not, nor be afraid of them. For the Lord thy God, he it is that does go with thee. He will not fail thee nor forsake thee. And Moses called unto Joshua and said unto him in the sight of all Israel, Kasak, amos. Be strong and of good courage. For thou must go with this people unto the land which the Lord has sworn unto their fathers to give them. And thou shalt cause them to inherit it. Well, what's happening there? The men and women of God are coming to take what was purchased, the promise. You are surrounded by 31 hostile empires. You know, that's what they were headed into. 31 empires on the other side of that Jordan River. 31. This is where we are at as the Church of Jesus Christ. Yet we are there without a war cry. Let's understand that we are out to win for the glory of Jesus Christ. And even if we die, we win. Doesn't matter what happens to our bodies. We obey, God wins. Now suddenly we're crossing. Joshua is the same name for Jesus in the New Testament, by the way. Yeshua. This is the Savior, the man of salvation, who has come in to bring us into the inheritance. Be strong and of good courage. For unto this people shall thou divide for an inheritance the land which I swore unto their fathers to give them. Have I not commanded thee? Be strong and of good courage. Rock the sock. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed. For the Lord thy God is with thee, whithersoever thou goest. Rock the sock, Israel. Rock the sock, men and women of God Almighty. Let all the powers of earth and hell that come against your soul, and all the powers of earth and hell that are puppeteering the lost masses, you hit them square in the teeth. And you show love to this world, to anyone who would spit in your face. You serve them and you love them in return and say, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. Rock kasak, Israel. Rock kasak.
wow, right? I think I've probably watched that video 50 times, and I still get chills, and I'm still, like, pumped up after I watch it. So if that doesn't get you fired up, you probably should just go now, because I don't have anything else better than that. So, but the key is, like, that fires you up, right? But don't get fired up and then walk out of here and then just go back to the way you are, because we need to stay fired up. That's the only way that the world and the enemy is going to hear our war cry, is if we stay fired up. So we must live victorious every day in Christ, in Yeshua. That's a must. We have to. So are we living like that? Are we living every day victorious? I can't speak for everyone here, but I know for me, I'm not. So we have to do that. We have to have our war cry be heard. Most people don't realize we're even at war, though. And that's exactly what the adversary wants. He doesn't want us to know we're at war, because then we can fight. And he knows that we have all the spiritual armor to fight. So what war? Because he would have you think we're at peace, right? He would have you think we're at peace. But that's the message of the Antichrist himself, is a false peace and a false message and a false doctrine. Unfortunately, you see the world one big happy family, right? Coexist, okay? We know, we hear that, see that bumper sticker? That fires me up just to see the bumper sticker. I'm sure we all know the bumper sticker I'm talking about. That's the lie of the Father, and that's what he wants. And he's the father of all lies. So why would we believe that to begin with? So don't let him deceive you. And he's been lying to us since the beginning of creation, since the day in the garden. He's been lying to us. But it needs to stop now. But it will only stop when we get our war cry back. So let's take a look at when he took over the reign of the earth, I should say. So let's go back to the beginning. We all know the story, Genesis 1, 27 through 31. I'm not going to read the whole scripture, but we know the story. This is the sixth day of creation. It says, on the sixth day of creation, Yahweh made man, and along with him, Eve. So in the beginning, Adam had reign over the earth, right? He was in charge of the animals, the birds of the heaven, the fish of the seas. They had plants for food. He was in charge of all that, but it didn't last long. That was Genesis 1. Genesis 3, just a couple chapters down, Satan robs Adam of his power to have dominion over the earth. And how does he do that? Because Adam and Eve didn't have their war cry. They failed to be obedient to the Creator, just as, you know, we're taught to do now if we're taught against the Torah. And because they did, they brought sin and death into the earth through that disobedience. And Satan, Hasatan, took over. Adam relinquished his authority. So the adversary didn't waste much time, did he? No, he pretty much started right in the garden with it. Romans 5:12, for this reason, even as through one man sin entered the world, and death through sin, and thus death spread to all men because all sinned. So this scripture is referring back to the garden when Adam was disobedient and Eve was disobedient and Satan took over. That's when man willfully sided with Satan. Now, I'm sure Adam didn't think he was willfully siding with Satan, but every day and every time we sin, that's exactly what we're doing. We're willfully siding with Satan. It needs to be no more. No more. Now, when that happened, I'm sure the adversary gladly jumped up and down. Oh, you know, he's taken over dominion of the earth, including the political, spiritual, economic, educational systems, the whole world, because Scripture says that he reigns and rules. I have a few examples to prove that in case you don't believe me. 2 Corinthians 4:4 calls the adversary the mighty one of this age. 1 John 5:19 says, we know that we are of Elohim, and all the world lies in the wicked one. Ephesians 2:2 calls Satan the ruler of the authority of the air. And Galatians 1:4 describes this world as the present wicked age. And if that isn't enough, because I like my 2 to 3 witnesses in Scripture, and that's four, but one more. This is a dire warning to all of us. 1 Peter 5:8 says, be sober, watch, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. I don't know about you, but that sounds like a pretty serious warning to me. So he's seeking to devour. How can we fight back against that? We have to have our war cry. So this verse in 1 Peter shows that not only is Satan the current ruler of the world, he's waging war against all the children of Yahweh. And that means us. He's waging war. If we consider ourselves a child of Yahweh, then he's waging war against us. Let's take that seriously. But Satan doesn't want us to know that. He doesn't want us to know. He doesn't want us to know that he's in charge of the world, even though we know it's just for a brief time. But he doesn't want us to know. And he certainly doesn't want us to be able to fight against him or wage war back. Our ignorance is his best trick. And he's been pretty proficient so far, I would say. But that's why we're all here. We're all coming into the truth. We're able to fight him more now because we know how to fight him. we've fallen for it for too long, but it's time to stand up and fight. It's time to live the words we heard in the video, Rock Kazakh. It's time to be strong and courageous. Yahweh has given us everything that we need to do that. And we already know the end of the story. We know that our God's greater and mightier and stronger. So what do we have to fear? It's time to wage war. He's called us to that war. It's time to fight for him. We won't perish as long as we cling to him and we cling to his word, despite what the enemy tries to put in our heads. If we cling to him and his word, that's our hope. And that's what we know we have to cling to fight the war. The scriptures are great. They're pretty comprehensive. They tell us we're at war. They tell us who we're at war with. And they tell us how we need to fight the battle. And that's why Satan doesn't want us in our word. He doesn't want us in our scriptures, because then he knows that we know his tricks. And we know we're here to fight. 2 Corinthians 10:2-5, this is Paul speaking. He says, "But I pray that when I am present, I might not be bold with that bravery which I think to be bold against some who reckon us as if we walked according to the flesh. For though we walk in the flesh, we do fight according to the flesh, for the weapons we fight with are not fleshly, but mighty in Elohim for overthrowing strongholds, overthrowing reasonings and every high matter that exalts itself against the knowledge of Elohim." 2 Corinthians 10 is a good example, just like Ephesians 6 that we read were, telling us who we're fighting against and that we're not fighting against flesh, not against flesh and blood. We're fighting against the demonic strongholds that Satan himself has brought. So we need to remember the war is spiritual. It's not natural, and we're at war, and we need to remember that every day. In order to fight and fight Yahweh's way, not our way, not our way, but his way, we have to take up the weapons he gave us. We have to obey his words. We have to be strong and courageous. And we must shout our war cry every day, loudly. Rock Kazakh, Kazakh Amatz. The ancient war cry, as the video said, throughout all the generations of the Hebrew people, throughout all the generations of Israel, the ancient war cry. And again, if we're Israel, then we take part in that. Just like we want to take part in the blessings, we take part in this as well. And as chosen fellow Hebrews, we have to have the war cry. That's part of it. It's a call to stand up. It's a call to all his people to fight. We know he's a mighty warrior. He's calling us to be that. So can we be that for him? Can we fight his battles here and let him be in control of us? That's what it's all about. So we talked, we listened to the video, and it talked a little bit about that, what it actually means, be strong and courageous. So let's talk a little bit and break it down, the Rock Kazakh, because I found it interesting. Rock, the video says, is the rock-like oomph. So I'm like, as an English major, I'm like, what is oomph? That's not even a word. Well, guess what? It actually is a word. And it's in the dictionary. So it means to have quality of being excited or energetic. That's actually a word. Somebody doesn't agree with me, but it really is, I promise. It's the rock-like oomph of the spiritually zealous heart. It's a steadfast excitement or energy of someone who is spiritually eager. Proverbs 23:17, we may not have ever seen it like this, but it actually describes what that means. Proverbs 23:17 says, "Do not let your heart envy sinners, but be in reverence of Yahweh all day long." That key word there is reverence. One translation of the word reverence is eager, spiritually eager or zealous. I didn't know that. I've never known that until I started to study this. And that makes sense because that's what we're called to do. We're called to do that all day long. So that's part of it. So does that describe us? I mean, we need to ask ourselves these questions. Are we spiritually eager? Are we spiritually zealous? And are we in reverence of him all day long? Because it's not a suggestion. That's what he tells us to do. So we need to be asking ourselves these questions. We're commanded to do that. But that's only part of it. Kazakh actually had quite a few different meanings when I looked up, as most Hebrew words do for everybody who's taken Hebrew. We know that there's not just one. There's a bunch. That can be confusing. However, it can help you study the word and figure out what is actually being said in the word. So let's take a look at a Kazakh. The video describes Kazakh as the game face of a mighty man. And think about, as we talk about these things, if this is us, if someone would describe us like this. Tenacity of soul, gritting of the teeth of the spiritually spirit-inspired warrior, and the baring of those teeth to the enemy. A flush of spiritual fervor, a tensing of all of a soldier's muscles. So simply put, Kazakh means to possess a resolute and growling resolve for the glory of Yahweh. So do we have that? Would that be some way that if I was to say, describe me, would you use those words? Would I use those words for you? Do we have tenacity of soul? Do we have spiritual fervor? Would other people identify, whether we know other people or not, would they identify us like that? That's something we need to think about. 2 Corinthians 4:6 describes this resolve that we are commanded to have. It says, "For Elohim, who said, 'Let light shine out of the darkness,' is the one who has shown in our hearts for the enlightening of the knowledge of the esteem of Elohim in the face of Yeshua the Messiah." A light shining in the darkness. Does that sound familiar? That's what we're called to be. That's the resolve that we're supposed to have. It may seem passive, but it's really not, because that's what Yahweh calls us to be, is that light. Because to be the light could be all someone needs. That could be, they see Yeshua in you, and if they don't, we're not shining the light. This is the resolve that we have to have. That's what we're commanded. So Rock Hazak means having all strength and glory and power and strength for him. Not for us, not for our agendas, but for him. That's what it means. So do we have it? Do we have it individually? Do we have Rock Hazak as a body of believers? These are questions we have to ask ourselves, and we need to, especially now. If we don't, in these last days, we will certainly fall prey to the enemy. No doubt about it. Scripture warns us over and over again. If we don't do this, then we'll fall prey, because we'll be deceived. We'll be disillusioned. And that's not what he wants for his believers. So we have to be on top of this. We have to have a war cry. So how can we be strengthened and courageous as Yahweh commands us? Well, we spoke about putting on his armor, and that's spiritual and physical protection. Well, in my research, I found another illustration of how to prepare yourself for battle. This is a step-by-step guide on how to gird your loins. I'm not going to go into detail on this one. I'll just let all the men take a look, and you can see how another way to prepare yourself for battle. And even though it's funny to think about, and as I was looking through it, I'm like, okay, that's pretty funny. It has a lot of significance when we really, really think about what it means in Scripture to do that, to gird our loins. So let's talk about that. As children of Yahweh, we're always to be ready. We're always to be prepared for battle. This is mobility and preparation, and it means a readiness for battle without restriction. That means that we're ready to fight always. There's no restriction. We can do battle without hindrance, physical or spiritual. This is a preparation that ensures our victory, but it's really his victory that we're ensuring over the spiritual warfare. So are we doing this? Are we ready? Are we prepared? Are we wearing his armor every day? And just like I said, it really started to change my days. After Pastor Jeff did the study on the armor, I did the verses every day, and it was it's hard to put into words. It was something completely different that I experienced through the day. I felt better. I felt more assured. I felt more confident. So put on the battle armor every single day. Even if you feel silly, and I would stand there and put on the helmet and all that, do it. Do it. You'll be surprised what it will do for you. So in Scripture, who are the examples where we see this type of behavior? Well, the first one I always go to is Yeshua, because he is our example. He's our perfect example, and we should always start with him. Now, I'm not going to read the scriptures, but Matthew 4, 1 through 11, and a comparative verse, Luke 4, 1 through 13, we all know the story. This is the example of Yeshua going up against the enemy and with his own war cry and the word of his Father. He was led up into the wilderness by the Ruach to be tempted by the devil. We all know that. So at the end of the 40 days and 40 nights, when he was tired and hungry, I can't even imagine. I mean, broken down, but not. Satan tempted him in many, many ways. Not just one, but many. But did Yeshua compromise? Did he ever sin one time? No. So what better example can we have? I mean, he knew that Satan ruled the kingdoms of the world. He knew that the world belonged to the adversary, but he stood firm on this word of the Father, and that's all he needed. This was his war cry. That's all he had to have. And we know he never bowed down to the adversary even once. So I like to say, let me think about that. What would I have done? Would I have done that? How would we have reacted if we were in the wilderness after fasting for 40 days and 40 nights, tired and hungry? Would we have bowed down for the piece of bread? Would we have done that? Or would we have yelled our war cry out? So hasn't happened to me. I don't know if it's happened to any of y'all. But either way, we're faced with stuff every day. Maybe not that drastic, but we're faced with it. So what do we do, you know, in the face of spiritual warfare and adversity? What do we do? Do we react like that? Do we think of our scriptures to answer the problems, the questions that come? Well, we're going to have our faith tested more and more, so we need to stand on the word. And the word says be strong and courageous, and that's what we need to be. We need to have our war cry. Kazak also means to make strong, to strengthen, confirm, or restore. I like the word restore. That makes me think even deeper into what that means. Isaiah 41:13, "For I, Yahweh, your Elohim, will strengthen your right hand, saying to you, 'Do not fear, I shall help you.'" Now, let's think about that and think about the words that were the definitions of Kazak. I see, when I think of that scripture, he He's strengthening my right hand. You see a beautiful picture of Yahweh holding your hand, lifting us up and strengthening us. I mean, he does that every day, but we have to call out to him, or he doesn't have to do that. I mean, it says he won't forsake us. I believe it. I mean, I believe what it says. So I have to start living like that. So he's holding us up. He's strengthening us. He gives us our rock chazak. He restores our power and strength. It also means to have your strength restored or renewed by the addition of his strength, not ours, not anything we can possibly do, no matter how many things we do, how many works we do. It's his strength that gives us the power to exist, to live, and to fight for him. And when I think about that, and I think about how awesome the Father is, even though we don't deserve it, it's humbling. It's very humbling, because in words you can't describe, you know, how awesome he is. But if you think of that picture of him lifting us up, that gives me a little bit more insight into it, and I hope it will you as well. So he strengthens his people. He strengthens us against the enemy to wage war against him. He gives us everything we need. So in Scripture, chazak amatz is actually the term that you see. Amatz is described as heavenly audacity, confidence in victory, even before the battlefield of battle is taken. That's the key words there, even before. Lambs moving with liquid ferocity into the lion's lair and rushing headlong into the most hazardous and impossible battles without pausing to consider the impossibilities. So when we proceed into something, is that how we proceed into it? For me, I'm a planner, so I like to plan every single second I can. But what I've discovered is I can't, and I'm not in control anyway. And some things I would have never found myself doing, like this, for example, I'm doing. But that's because of him. I heard that wrong. That's because of him, not me. So rushing in and knowing he's on our side, that's the important thing. We have to know that. We have to really believe that. So Amatz is knowing that we, his children, or he, has already won the battle. It's already won. But we can only be assured of that if we're living like we're supposed to be, if we're his. So chazak amatz means all strength for him in the face of sure death. So in the scripture, who had amatz? We talked about Yeshua as the best example. He always is. The other one we discussed in the video, we'll talk about briefly, David and Goliath. I mean, that's an obvious example of chazak amatz. We know the story. It's 1 Samuel, if you want the scripture, 1 Samuel 17, 32 through 51. Now, if that isn't amatz, I don't know what is. Because we know David, he's standing up against Goliath, who was a giant Nephilim. He's rushed headlong into the battle, armed with barely anything. I mean, they tried to give him more, right? They wanted him to take more. No, he didn't need it. He had barely anything. And he didn't consider these possibilities, or he probably wouldn't have rushed in. But that's amatz. That's chazak amatz. And that's some serious one, because, I mean, we can't even envision what that would have looked like. Another example is in 2 Samuel. This one is 2 Samuel 23, 14 through 17. I'll read a little bit of this one. And David was then in the stronghold, while a watchpost of the Philistines was then in Bethlehem. And David longed and said, "Oh, that someone would give me a drink of the water from the well of Bethlehem, which is by the gate." And the three mighty men broke through the camp of the Philistines and drew water from the well of Bethlehem that was by the gate and took it and brought it to David. But he would not drink it, but poured it out to Yahuwah, and he said, "Far be it from me, O Yahweh, to do this, the blood of the men who went at the risk of their lives." So he would not drink it. This is what the three mighty men did. So when I first, you know, I'm sure everybody here has read the Bible multiple times, and I've read this story and read the story, it never dawned on me the importance of that portion, of the three mighty men. It just seems like part of the story, right? But when you study it and you're studying this, you see that even David realized that they had amatz. They were willing to run out through the battle to get a cool cup of water. That seems pretty intense to me. So they didn't even consider the possibilities. Would we? I mean, would we do that for a friend? Would we do that? Would we run through the battlefield to get a cool cup of water? Just think about it, because that's amatz. Numbers 13:30. After silencing the people, Caleb says, "Let us go up at once and take possession of the land, for we are certainly able to overcome it." Now Caleb, he was met with opposition, right? But Caleb himself had amatz. That is the exact definition of amatz. He said, "Let's go. Let's do it. We know we have Yahweh on our side. What else do we need?" He knew they were certainly able to overcome. The other people around him may not have, but he did. So let's think about the scenarios. David and Goliath, Daniel and the three mighty men. I think I said David earlier. We met Daniel. Sorry. Caleb at the before they headed into the Promised Land and think about ourselves. Would we have done the same thing that David did when he was faced with the giant? Because we may not have a big giant man standing here, but we have giants in our lives that we come up against all the time. So would we have done that? Would we have reacted the same? Would we risk our life to get the cool cup of water? Would we have been strong and courageous when entering the land? Because we may not be entering that promised land, that physical promised land, but we're entering a promised land, guarantee it. And he wants us to come in, but he's waiting on us to get it right. And that's what we got to do. And we have to be strong and courageous when we're doing it. So Amaz is to be strong, alert, courageous, and brave, bold and determined, to exhibit strength, his strength, to be swift-footed, all-believing, and super-conquering, to have prevailing faith in the Lord of all battles, and that's Yeshua. All these men exhibited Amaz in the face of adversity. So will we? I ask each of us, when the enemy stands in our way, will we do the same thing that these men did in Scripture? Will we pick up our sword, which is, we know, the Word, because the Word tells us this is our sword, and fight? So there are lots of examples in Scripture. We gave a few. There are a few more that I have up here in the PowerPoint, which we'll get to in a minute. But mere men and women, they don't even know they're in a battle. They don't know they're in war. So they can't fight. But we, if we call ourselves children of Yahweh, we better start fighting, because he tells us we have to be strong and courageous. Romans 8:37-39 says, "But in all this we are more than overcomers through him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor messengers, nor principalities, nor powers, neither the present nor the future, nor height nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of Yahweh, which is Messiah Yeshua, our Master." That's pretty powerful. We're more than conquerors. We're overcomers. So we see the end, right? That's the end, actually. But we have to live to get to that point, to be that. Our power lies in Messiah. Scripture is very clear about that. We have to take hold of him, and then we'll get the promises, but we have to take hold first. We're redeemed. We need to remember that. We're bought with a price by the precious blood of our Savior. We're bought with a price. We're redeemed to worship, to sacrifice, and to be obedient, and not follow our ways. Even though our ways may seem right, what does Scripture say about our ways? They're not. We need to follow his ways. Just like the Israelites were led out of the bondage of Egypt by Moses, we're led out of bondage and redeemed by Yeshua, our Messiah. And he delivered us from bondage. We should be living free now. This should be what we consider our freedom, and it is. He led us from sin and death and hell. And because we're bought with a price, we are changed into the body of Yeshua. We are changed into his body. We need to start acting like it. It's now or never, because the end's coming, and it's not going to wait on us to get it right. We just need to get it right. So what's the body missing? What are we missing? Well, Yahweh is calling us, but we're living powerless. We're living powerless. We are not using what he has given us. We're not. And we're in despair because of it. So if we can't even keep the enemy out of our churches, then what can we do? We're powerless if we can't do that. And he's done a lot of them. He's done a lot. So a church without the power of Yahuwah, without a war cry, is void of his presence. And who wants to be here if his presence is not? Because there's no purpose in being here if it isn't. That's not where I want to be. Just imagine what would happen if the world, if we began to have the Kazakh and Amatz that our biblical forefathers had. We have to get back to that. We would witness a mighty move of the Creator, more so than anything we've ever seen, parallel to Shavuot, probably. I mean, if we were to get back where we need to be. Because the Ruach, we know, came into the men that day at Pentecost or Shavuot. But that was Kazakh and Amatz. That's what that is all about. It's about his spirit. It's about his spirit as a warrior. The church in Acts, they took hold of that promise. And that's what we need to do, too, if we want to do this, want the same. We want the blessings, the promises, the inheritance. We have to be strong and courageous. We must stand up and proclaim him. We must exalt his name in all the earth. That's what we're supposed to do. Then and only then will he make us the mighty warriors he's commanded us to be. And command is a big word. Not suggested, not said maybe if you want, but commanded. That means we need to do it. In the final speech of Moses, his instructions to the Israelites as they were about to enter the Promised Land, he laid out ground rules for the kingdom that they were about to establish. What did he tell them? He said, be strong and courageous. Be of good courage. He said, Kazakh Amatz. Deuteronomy 31, 6 through 8. Be strong and courageous. Do not fear nor be afraid of them, for it is Yahweh your Elohim who is going with you. He does not fail you nor forsake you. And Moshe called Yehoshua and said to him before the eyes of all Israel, be strong and courageous, for you are going with this people to the land which Yahuwah has sworn to their fathers to give them, and you are to let them inherit it. Moses tells Joshua, be strong and courageous. How many times do we have to hear this to get it right? Because it says it. I didn't count, but it's a lot, I'm sure. Don't be afraid. He won't fail us, and he won't forsake us. When I'm reading it, he's talking to me, okay? He's talking to the Israelites, but he's talking to me, and he's talking to all of us. Moses says these words over and over again. The men and women of Yahweh, they were about to cross into the promised land. They were about to take what was already purchased for them, the promise of the seed for generations to come. They were surrounded by hostile nations. Does that sound familiar? Every day we're surrounded. We need to start seeing it not like nations. It was nations then, but for us it's something else. But it is still there. It is still the same. It is still the same. Their war cry had to be heard. And we're in the exact same place as a church and a body of believers, but here without a war cry, and that needs to change. When we begin to get it back, when we begin to get the Chazak and Amatz back, we'll see revival, but not until then. And everyone wants to see revival, right? But it starts with us. It has to start with us, because if it doesn't, it's not real. And I see a lot of revivals out there in the news. They're not all real, because obedience follows revival, and I don't see obedience. And it's important that we understand those things, they can't be separated. The Spirit came to write the law in our hearts. So if we don't have obedience, is what spirit was it that came? Okay? That's not in my notes, but I just thought of that. So as the body, we each have an individual purpose, right? But we as a collective body have a collective purpose. And we need to get both of them right. That purpose, one of those purposes, is to wage war against evil. Scripture says we need to expose it. We need to expose evil. We need to remain obedient to Yahweh. Individually, we do our part, but as a body, since I'm speaking to a body, and myself included, we have to come together as Yeshua as the head. Now, how many times as a body can we remain quiet, either within the church or on the outside? We can't remain quiet. We can't let the adversary win. We need to get on the narrow path. That's very narrow, but we need to get on there. And we can't expect different results until we do that. We can't expect victory, real victory, in our lives until we do that. We have to wake up and realize that we're a body that needs to fight against evil. We have to bring the good news, and we must love one another in doing it. Sometimes it seems like tough love, but it's still love, and we have to bring it with love and with the kindness. That's our war cry, and we have to let it be heard. We have to let it be heard. Earlier we spoke about Joshua, who is a metaphorical savior of sorts. Joshua was a mighty warrior chosen by Yahweh to bring his people into the promised land. He brought his people into the fulfillment of the promise because he had Rock Chazak. He had Chazak Amatz. Do we think he could have done that if he didn't? But Yahweh knew he had it. He was already chosen by Yahweh. He had it. He knew. So here I have a few more examples in scripture of that. And they're listed up here. I have 1 Chronicles 28:20, Psalms 27:1, Isaiah 41:10, Isaiah 54:4, and 1 Corinthians 16:13. I'm sure that's not a comprehensive list, but it's some that I remembered that jumped out at me. And through it all, we have to remember, as we have our Chazak Amatz, what the battle is all about and who it is all about. And we have to seek victory on his behalf and always, always for his glory. Never ours, but always for his. So I'm going to read three scriptures just from a small section of Deuteronomy that talk about this so we can see the real emphasis that's put on this. Because honestly, until I saw that video, and that's been a few months ago, I never realized or recognized be strong and courageous as a command. But I sure do now, now that I'm reading the scriptures and I'm seeing it over and over. Let's start with Deuteronomy 7, 1 through 2. When Yahweh, your Elohim, brings you into the land which you go to possess, he shall also clear away many nations before you. The Hittites and the Girgashites and the Amorites and the Canaanites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites, seven nations greater and mightier than you. And when Yahweh your Elohim gives them over to you, you shall smite them and put them under the ban completely. Make no covenant with them and show them no favor. So as we read through these scriptures, we're going to see a couple things that jump out over and over again. Again in Deuteronomy 7, 22 through 24, And Yahweh your Elohim shall deliver them over to you and destroy them with a great destruction until they are consumed. And he shall give their sovereigns into your hand, and you shall destroy their name from under the Shemayim. No one is going to be able to stand against you until you have destroyed them all. And the last one, Deuteronomy 9, 1 through 3. Hear, O Yisrael, you are passing over the Jordan today to go in to dispossess nations greater and stronger than yourself, cities great and walled up to the Shemayim, a people great and tall, the descendants of the Anakim, whom you know and of whom you heard it said, who stands before the descendants of Anak? And you shall know today that Yahweh your Elohim is he who is passing over before you as a consuming fire. He destroys them and subdues them before you. So you shall dispossess them and destroy them quickly, as Yahweh has said to you. So what do we see in those three verses? Over and over again, he tells them, you're going into the land, you're going to dispossess the nations, you're going to put them under the ban, and you're going to basically dwell in the land. And he gives them this reassurance over and over that he's with them, that they can do it. I mean, that's only three scriptures or a few scriptures from Deuteronomy. It's in there everywhere. But I see this in these scriptures. He tells us the same thing. This is the same thing he's telling us in our current situation today. So we see over and over he's going to deliver the enemy into the hands. But we must be strong and courageous. We must pick up our swords and we must fight. Our war cry has to be heard. If we do this, he is clear. He'll provide the way. If we do it our own way, he probably won't. But we have to do it his way. We must not be concerned what happens to our bodies. This one here is something that we have to really think about as persecution is coming. It's already here, but not anywhere close to the fulfillment that it's coming. Because it's coming and it's going to be hard. So we have to be not concerned with our bodies. Scripture says, Matthew 10, 28 says, and do not fear those who kill the body, but are unable to kill the being, but rather fear him who is able to destroy both being and body in Gehenna. And in Luke 12, 4 through 5, it says, but I say to you, my friends, do not be afraid of those who kill the body, and after that unable to do any more, but I shall show you whom you should fear. Fear the one, after killing, possesses the authority to cast into Gehenna. Yes, I say to you, fear him. So Yahweh is telling us, if we have to sacrifice ourselves to martyr ourselves, that is a blessing for us. That's a huge, tremendous blessing for us. We cannot be worried about what happens to us physically. Our job is to spread the good news, show love, be obedient, and what happens, he will take care of the rest. Physical death is insignificant in comparison to what Yahweh has in store for those who overcome. I mean, can you even imagine what he has in store for those who overcome? As hard as I try, I can't imagine how great it will be. But I'll keep trying to imagine and be obedient during that time to make sure I'm part of that. I'm part of that remnant and those people that overcome. If we obey, Yahweh wins and Satan's defeated. And we already know he is. But we're part of the plan, so we have a role to play in that. It's not that simple. But in order for that to happen, we have to be victorious in his will. We know the Father's already won. I want to conclude with a quote from Eric Lundy. It was his graduation speech, and it was part of what we saw in the video. It was very powerful. His words are really powerful. He says, all the powers of earth and hell that come against your soul, and all the powers of earth and hell that are puppeteering the lost masses, hit them square in the teeth and show love to this world. To anyone who would spit in your face, serve them. Remind you of anyone? Reminds me of someone in the scriptures. And say, Father, forgive them. Rock Kazakh, Israel. Rock Kazakh. In order to be victorious, we have to be obedient and follow him. Matthew 16, 24 and Luke 9, 23, this is part of what he means when he quotes the words of Yeshua are quoted. If anyone wants to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his stake daily and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life shall lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake shall save it. Those are powerful words, but that's what it's all about. We have to take up our stake. We have to follow him daily. We have to have a war cry. It has to be his life, not mine. We have to go to war with the enemy, knowing that Yahweh is with us and for us, and the enemy will be defeated. Don't forget that there are lots of souls out there to save. That's part of what we're supposed to do. Plant the seeds. Talk to them. Romans 6:22 says, but now, having been let free from sin and having become servants of Elohim, you have your fruit resulting in the holy ones and the end everlasting. That's what our fruit is all about. The world has to see Yeshua in our fruit. If they don't, then they may never come to know him. And then we've lost. We've lost. It's our calling. This is our purpose. And it should be our greatest desire to do this. We need all strength and courage for the glory of God. And all strength and courage in the face of battle. We need to be strong and courageous. Rock, Kazakh, Israel, where is your war cry? Let's all pray. Father, we thank you so much for this Shabbat. We thank you for the Father that you are. We thank you for knowing what we needed before we even ourselves know. Father, for everyone in this room, I pray for them. I pray for us individually and as a body. Father, we thank you for your presence that you bring to us. We thank you for your armor that you give us. We know that you're with us as we fight. And we will fight, but we will have the confidence in knowing that you're there. Father, I thank you. I thank you for everything that you've given us, for all the blessings that you give us every single day. We thank you for the scriptures to tell us what and how we need to live our lives, for the holy word that you gave us, and for bringing the Ruach to teach us and to help us understand and to bring us closer and closer to you each and every day. Father, today and every day, we thank you and we praise you. In the name above all names, Yeshua HaMashiach, we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Let's pray for the children.
Oh my God. Oh, I'm gonna thank you though.
Here comes some children. Here come some children. They are. Good. Let's pray. Abba, in the name of Yeshua, we lift up our children to you. We ask your richest blessings on them. In everything that they put their hand to, even right now, as little as they are or however young they are, Lord, let them know your word, let them know your spirit, and let them walk in the way. Let us as adults show them the way so that there's no confusion. They know what to do. They know what decisions to make and how to make them, and that they would grow up to be awesome men and women of Yah, knowing your word, never having turned from it and have to recover from mistakes and recover from things that should have never happened because they weren't taught. Please let us be the ones to teach them and let them learn it. We just ask your hand to be on them and never take them off. A protective hedge built around them so that they are protected. And everywhere they go, everywhere their foots go, when they're in school, when they're at home, when they're playing, but that your hand would be on them for good, never for evil. And we thank you for them. Bless them. In the name of Yeshua, we ask it. Amen, amen. Tanya gave me a great idea for this priestly blessing. Let's everybody sing it. Everybody sing it, okay? May the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord shine his face to you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his face to you and give to you peace. Shabbat shalom.
Yahweh, hear from heaven. Grant all the desires of our hearts. Fulfill all our purposes and all our petitions. May Yahweh.
quickly answer all our requests and save us in the day of adversity. In the name of Yeshua the Messiah, defend us from our enemies, from poverty and from bondage. Shabbat shalom.